And thank you very much for coming to join us this morning. I know there are lots of interesting things going on all around SPRU, so it's great that so many people have made it here. I'm not going to spend lots of time introducing the panel. I think a lot of people in this room are already pretty familiar with the questions that we're here to think about. But essentially, just to give people a very brief introduction, really we're here because over the last few years we've seen some quite profound shifts in the way that politics is happening in Europe, including here in the UK, but also all across the countries, many of our neighbouring countries. And those aren't just shifts about addressing some extremely challenging issues like climate change or youth unemployment and so on. We're also seeing some quite significant shifts in the way that politics happens. So, whereas at one time, across much of Europe, we would have looked to democratic institutions as the kind of arbiters of and sort of planners for the way that our societies worked and trusted in the levers of democracy to deliver the outcomes that we want, we're now in a situation where we're seeing very many people no longer having faith in those sorts of systems and those sorts of institutional frameworks and turning to protest and other forms of organising to challenge the power structures to try and develop solutions that may not be those that we hear articulated in sort of formal political spaces. So today I'm joined by four people who are in their day-to-day lives thinking and working on many of those challenges and exploring some of the solutions and what they may look like. And I'll introduce them down the panel. So we're joined firstly by Richard Jolly, who comes to us from the Institute of Development Studies. Richard sadly has to leave us for a personal matter quite early on, so he's going to be speaking first. Then Phil Johnston is a research fellow here at SPRU. Then here we've got, is that my left? I was going to say on my left, and then I had a moment of doubt. This is Tina Caballero, who is an organiser and an activist, and also the international spokesperson for Podemos Feminismos. She's based in Cáceres at the moment, but she's also worked for Podemos here in the UK. And then on the very end, we're joined by Gappy Bola, who is the lead organiser for the New Economy Organisers Network in Europe. So that was initially a kind of network seeded by the think tank New Economics Foundation here in London. Their primary focus was originally on the UK, and Guppy's really been pioneering, exploring some of those, taking some of those ideas out and building those networks more broadly across Europe. So I won't waste any more time. I want to hand the floor to, particularly to Richard, at the first opportunity. Just to give people a bit of a sense of how the process works, we'll be asking for sort of 3 to 5 minutes intro from each of our speakers. They'll be giving us a bit of an idea of their thoughts on some of these subjects and also their connection to the issues. And then we're going to move pretty quickly to taking questions and comments from the floor. And my understanding is that we're joined not only by attendees at the conference here today, but also by people more broadly from the community near us here in Sussex. So I hope we'll be hearing a mixture of different sorts of contributions. All right, with no further ado, Richard.
Thank you very much, and many apologies that I'm just going to have to leave and miss out the discussion. And all the other presentations, which is particularly sad because to me there's no simple answers in this issue. Democracy, Europe, transition, austerity, it's work in progress, or at least it's events sometimes in progress forward, often sideways, and I'm afraid too often backwards. So we need to find out how to relate to this. My experience goes back to the 1980s and 90s when I was working for UNICEF and heavily involved with the adjustment programs, as they were called at that time. About 300 adjustment programs in about 54 countries. And thinking about the democratic or lack of democracy, I wanted to make 5 points. Almost all these programs, 300 of them, were negotiated in secrecy, usually by either some officials from the Ministry of Finance in the country, occasionally by the minister himself, even more occasionally by the president of the country, never by all the cabinet. It was a total lack of democracy. Secondly, on the side of the IMF and World Bank, who were the main negotiators with any government, were usually someone in their 20s or 30s, young people with very limited experience. I met one of them in the World Bank. He'd just come back from, I think it was, Jamaica. And he was telling me, I was asking about his experience. He said when he climbed in the plane, he looked out the window and saw people rioting in the streets. And he said to himself, I was glad at least he asked the question, in what way am I involved in that? Thirdly, and here's a quote from a very good book for those of you who are interested in the governance dimensions, the global governance, book by Mark Mazawa, A History of an Idea, and it's a quote worth reading. Most of the economists in the World Bank and the IMF had little interest in history, nor in the other social sciences. Its staffs were mostly male, almost entirely economists, trained in American and English universities. Entering the IMF and the World Bank in the 1980s, they were rational expectation revolutionaries. I haven't got time to explain that to the non-economists, who based their prescriptions on in-house templates couched in the language of highly formalized mathematical models that the profession was coming to prize. They existed in a state of more or less total ignorance of the cultures, languages, or institutions of the countries they had been told to cure, having been trained, as many economists still are, to believe that this ignorance, being a matter of exogenous variables, did not matter. Well, that's so much the professionalism, so-called, which is why I think the element of finding out what people think and the issues of democracy and broader involvement is vital. Almost all these programs, my fourth point, were disastrous in terms of even economic growth. For those of you who live in England and hear the way Osborne keeps going on and on and on about how this program is necessary to tackle debt and to get back to growth. Well, what happened in Latin America and Africa was that growth went down in Latin America to plus 9% over the 20-year period for capita growth, and 1980 to 2000, compared with 80% over the preceding 20 years. That's a 20-year growth rate. Latin, for sub-Saharan Africa, growth was minus 15% per capita from 1980 to 2000, compared with 36% of the earlier 20 years. So a mass of research since then has explored all the ups and downs, the successes and the failures, summarized in a brilliant book by James Vreeland, if any of you want to look at it, in which he says, so the newly emerging consensus is that IMF programs of adjustment, but it could be called austerity, hurt economic growth, let alone education, health, and all the other things. So let me end with three conclusions more focused on your debate, democracy. True democracy and more public debate will, in my view, help, but by itself is not enough. In addition is needed the media, because we need to have broader, less biased treatment of the issues in the media. Not Tina, there is no alternative, but more objective reporting of how often other countries have tackled debt, deficits, with what results, short-term, long-term, and so forth. Somehow those issues must be fed into the debate, as they notoriously were not in the British recent election. Second, more analysis of the ideas and ideology underlying austerity, whose interests they serve, and how they stack up against careful economic analysis and evidence is needed. That's vital. That's where the academic world, to my mind, comes in. That's why I greatly welcome the people who've been protesting against traditional economics. And thirdly, mobilization of public opinion, especially of the next generation. I only wish I could hear how you react to all these things. But thank you for letting me We did do at IDS a little booklet, big one behind, Be Outraged, There Are Alternatives, and so forth. And I will listen for 3 minutes.
Okay, excellent. Can we, let's give Richard a quick round of applause to say thank you so much for that.
As Hannah said, I work for Podemos. I'm an activist, I'm not an academic. I'm not a politician either, so this is quite unprecedented. In spite of this transition, I hope that Spain and hopefully Europe is going through in terms of new politics, which is that normal people are taking this space of politics that it used to be, especially in Spain, it used to be taken by the same people generation after generation, what we call in Podemos la casta, the caste. So the situation that we are living at the moment in Spain, and especially in regards to Podemos, is a quite delicate situation. As you might already know, Podemos started a year and a half ago and very quickly became kind of like the first or second political force within the country, but obviously within the last year and a half we suffered the consequences of the smear campaign coming by every single angle of society and media. And so at the moment the polls, they are in between 11-15% of results within the general elections that we're going to have at the end of the year. So at the end of the year we're having general elections. And this is a very difficult situation at the moment, as well as we were discussing before. What Podemos has done is has created a new language to speak about what is happening in Spain. So as I was saying, we're talking, for example, about La Casta and discussing all the ways in which corruption works within Spain, political corruption especially. But this has been hijacked by a new political party called Ciudadanos that has erupted the political arena in the last 6 months and has become the third and fourth political force, very together with Podemos. Ciudadanos is a new political force that basically says that it's doing exactly the same as Podemos. It wants to fight against corruption, wants to do exactly the same as Podemos, but of course it's backed by the banks, and it's a new, they're right wing, they're against immigration, so they have all this right wing ideology, but they have hijacked all the ideas of Podemos. So basically we're in a very very delicate situation, especially for what is happening in Greece as well. This is affecting very much. We thought that eventually at the end of the year we could reunite forces within Europe, and Podemos and Syriza could create some kind of like starting ground for a new type of politics, but this is becoming a bit more difficult than what we expected. Nevertheless, we have some battles that we've won. And in local elections, we can say that we won the two major cities of Spain. So at the moment, Barcelona and Madrid, they are governed by citizen platforms. So Barcelona, the new mayor of Barcelona, it's Ada Colau, who is an activist. And her party, it's a completely different type of political party as we've had before, I think, everywhere really, and especially in Spain, but also in Europe. So her platform is a citizen platform. It's formed by different political parties. One of them is Podemos, but you have also the Greens, and you have Equo, and you have another citizen platforms, and it's the same for Madrid, pretty much, with Manuela Carmena. And so, in one side, we have two women being mayors, which is completely unprecedented in Spain. We don't have many women. Well, we do, but anyway, long story. we don't want to talk about those women because they are from the right wing and they're like just men, basically. They're not women, really. So for first time, we have this unprecedented circumstance, which is the two main cities of Spain, they are governed by these two pretty radical activists, and they are already starting to make changes at the local level. So they are stopping contracts with big energy companies. They are stopping the privatization of different services that all the previous governments they have started. So there is a change going on, and there is things that are happening. But of course, as she's gone, as Richard was saying, there are different things that are necessary for democracy, and I totally agree in what he was saying, which is the media. Of course, the media in Spain, everywhere, is massively taken by groups that are completely neoliberal, and it's very difficult to actually make any kind of change with all the media being taken by those forces. So this is very, very, very tricky thing, the analysis of austerity and the mobilization of public opinion, which is not going to happen if we don't have another type of media.
Excellent.
That's it. Yeah.
Thank you. Gathy, can I move to you, and then we'll come to Phil for the closing bit of this, and then we'll hear from the floor.
Sure. And then I'm going to steal something that Phil told me earlier. In passing.
That's a low blow.
So my name is Gathy Bowler. I'm really excited to be here because I started my job at the New Economics Foundation in January, and I'm still asking a lot of questions, which I hope you'll give me all the answers to in the next hour. I'm, as Hannah said, the lead organiser for the European New Economy Organisers Network, which is a long-winded way of saying I try to help facilitate and coordinate a network of activists who are trying to overturn neoliberalism for an economy based on social justice and environmental protection. Which is, when I started the job, I was like, hey, okay, give me 2-3 years, and I'll be able to do that. So the sort of beginning year is really to identify really exciting groups in Europe of activists, academics, political actors who are sort of basing their work solely on trying to look at systemic change. And learning from them, and Spain is one of the places which has inspired us the most, so I could use some examples from some of our learnings from Spain, but I'm going to leave that to Tina. I don't need to talk about the reasons why we need to get rid of neoliberalism. I think it's really obvious, especially when we discuss Europe. In my heart, when I think about Europe, I think about Europe. You know, the sort of like broad, horizontal mass of people who are living peacefully together, where we can travel around freely, we can work in different countries. In Britain, our cheese selection is all the better for it. And it's a good thing, right? And then when you think about Europe in your head, I think about these massive column institutions of power that have absolutely no democratic participation or remit. The ECB, I guess the IMF in the way, a role in the Greek negotiations. You could say to an extent Merkel, but then I think most member governments who have some power in Europe are governed by neoliberal ideology. And so it's neoliberalism that is the root cause of many of the problems that we see, and that's why NEF's focus is solely on trying to overturn it. So what is the new system? And that's a question that NEF have been asking for many years, for a long time, I think 30 years that they've been around. We've been creating lots of PDFs, putting them up on our website, hoping someone would read them, and then everything will be fine. And then the crash happened in 2008, and we were like, hey guys, we've got the answer, but no one was actually doing anything about it. No one had really picked up on A, the ideas and the evidence, and B, a narrative to follow through. In the media, we saw bankers talking about why the economic crash had happened, but there was no actual economist who could talk about the reasons why it happened, which was because of the failing system. So NEF began to realise they needed to sort of broaden their remit a little bit. So they changed from a think tank to a think do tank, which is the fancy way of saying they started engaging with some activists. We've also started engaging a little bit more with academics. And the aim with the network is not just to know each other, but it's to really build a community of power. So we've just realised there's very little alignment in these new ideas around transition. And that's not because we have different values. Everyone has the same values. It's that our principles are misaligned. We can't articulate what we want our values to be in the present. And we can't then put them into a narrative to explain to people. And if we can't do that, if we can't align ourselves, we're never going to be able to push ourselves with a bit of power into the present system. And so we're working with people who are, A, trying to bring the demise of the current system and trying to build the new one. And somewhere in between these two places is a bit of chaos, which is basically what I think we're seeing right now. I think we're beginning to see chaos. And every small failure around Syriza or whatever's happening in Spain with the sort of neoliberal party sort of taking over the rhetoric of Podemos, to the Tories getting back into power after, you know, completely messing up our country over the last 5 years and then having the remit to do it again. They seem like failures, but actually it's a chaos process, which excites me because it shows that there are some opportunities for us to take on and build on in the future. We try to instill an idea of long-term thinking. So this idea, the question, which I didn't actually realise was the question of this panel, which was, you know, how do we change? Well, what's the question? Something to do with electoral politics and transformation, right? Are elections important? And I think that's a really great question. Once we get into the discussion, it'll be really interesting to talk about the role of new political interventions, such as the Podemos, but also there's some really interesting things happening in Hungary and in Denmark and in France, where there are small groups creating citizen platforms or trying to think about new political systems and political cultures. And I think those are things that we should really be taking interest in. And then I'm really interested in this kind of, you know, you've got the academic, you guys, the academic sort of sphere, intellectuals, policymakers, you've got the activists who, so the idea creators and evidence and policy, activists who basically deliver those ideas in some way, and then political actors who may be able to implement. And A, they all need to start trusting each other in their own communities, and B, we need to start building institutions that allow for cross-fertilisation and for ideas to flow and then exist. We need to build better, stronger institutions that can challenge the current ones that we have. We need to start thinking about how we do that. So there's three things that, so I'm taking Richard's form. We need to trust each other a lot more, so we need to start building spaces where we can build relationships, because relationships precede action. We need to be applicable in our thoughts and also accountable, so we need to be diverse. We can't just be a room full of white middle-class intellectuals. We need to not just talk to people outside of our own sphere, but we actually need to build leadership in groups where we want those conversations to happen. And we need to be more directional, so we need to actually align ourselves and not just create transition towns and have intentional communities, but actually use those as a force of power to be able to push the old system away and build a new one. That's
excellent. Thank you, Kathy. And Phil, who is also a co-convener of this session as well. So,
yeah, thanks. And I don't want to talk for too long because I suppose I'm the token academic on this panel, and I'm more interested to hear what these guys have to say. Originally, Paul Mason was going to be on this panel. This is his book. So I sort of
retouch it later.
Yeah. So he can. So originally I was thinking, well, I might just try and pretend to be Paul Mason, but my I do a terrible Northern accent, and it would be a disaster. So I might talk a little bit about that book. I don't know if anyone's read it. But he's written this book on post-capitalism, A Guide to Our Future, where he's really looking towards what he sees, this pivotal moment that we're in, where capitalism is failing, really, and we're seeing crisis after crisis. We're getting into more debt. We're seeing things like Greece. And really, he's saying that we're reaching a point where something new has to emerge. The way he sees it emerging, which will be of interest to people who are into socio-technical theories of various kinds, is that the means by which a more horizontal, a more democratic society could be achieved is already in our hands through technology, through things like the internet, through all these various things. And the new kind of products that we're seeing, you cannot accrue value in the way that you used to be able to, because there's not the labour input into it. So it's a very kind of classic Marxist argument. I think it's, unfortunately, there is a chapter called On Transitions, but I haven't reached that far yet. But I will, if I imagine what he's going to say, is that through this technology that this society, I mean, it's a very common argument, Harton, Negri, Gibson, Graham, it's an argument that's been made before, and of course I don't really buy it, because essential thing is struggle and politics and these kind of things, so there's a lot of work that's going to have to be done. But I think, well, there was a, do you know Kojève? He was a French theorist from the 1940s who was actually really pivotal in driving the EU and the European project. A very strange character, there's very few photographs of him really. And he was a Hegelian, and he was a very good Hegelian. And he saw that the dialectic would be resolved through the expansion of Europe, that it would no longer have these contradictions between nations and so on, these kind of things. But unfortunately, Kojève, he was a very good Hegelian, but he wasn't a very good Marxist, which is the essential bit that's required to boot on top of Hegel. And what we're seeing in Europe at the moment is the central contradiction of having a free economic zone whilst having barriers on the movement of labour. And we're seeing that in terms of the catastrophic things happening with migration at the moment, that capital is allowed to move freely around the world and labour is prevented, and that's the central contradiction that Europe's clearly going to have to resolve, because the stats discussed in this book is that to sustain our economic model, you're going to have tens of millions more migrants, not less, and the UK is going to have that. And look what's happening, you know, people are outraged. Well, they're not outraged with migrants dying, they're outraged because they can't go on holiday. But that's the UK. But there are exciting things happening, and another thing I'll throw into the mix is, because we've discussed Podemos, Syriza, and there is the SNP, you know, this was an amazing thing. It's very uncomfortable for many people, myself included, because it has the word national in it. It's very, and I was very, very sceptical of it myself. Up until the week before the referendum, I was against it, and then the turning point was when Osborne marched up to and made a speech and said, "You Scottish people, you can't do this." And I said, "They must clearly want Scottish independence. Because if you send George Osborne up to try and boss people around in Scotland, that's really not a good plan." But I did go up there, and it was incredibly exciting because it was grassroots, and it was really, this wasn't just about the SNP, the Greens, the Socialists. There was a network of people involved. That really, there was this upsurge and struggle, and I think that was a very important movement. And the left, and Corbyn will do it, and that's exciting as well. But the left has to deal with the SNP, and it has to create alliances. I think party politics really is coming to an end. We need to move horizontally between parties. I've got a lot of Labour friends who I'm constantly arguing with on Facebook because they just will not accept that the Labour thing, it had its use, it had its purpose, but it needs to change, it needs to adapt, and I think we're at a very exciting moment in that regard. So that's just a few thoughts.
Excellent. Thank you very much, and thank you to you guys as well. So I think now's the moment to start taking questions and comments from the floor.
I spent 3 weeks in Greece this summer watching all the machinations that have occurred. Just want to offer, I mean, I love the commentary. I want to offer some things that might be helpful to you. First of all, the much maligned minister, ex-minister of finance, Varoufakis, whom I've known for 5 years. In fact, I've written editorials prior to his emergence in the political system on making education the business of Greece, because it's a missed opportunity. But in 2013, he gave a very, very important video, which is available. I can send it to you and you can disseminate it, on the origin of the European crisis, financial crisis. It was not about Greece. It was about the fault lines in the European financial system. And it traces it from the fall of Bretton Woods, the emergence of dollars, the standard, the partnership with Germany to basically dominate European and American finance. And by the way, also Japan, but China had another idea. But I really urge this to be watched, because it is, as I say, before he was thrust into politics, it's not Greek specific, but it's enormously helpful to know how basically cheap money was circulated in order to fund export-oriented economies. We know about that, and we know the consequences of all of that. Now, to jump ahead, and that was in response to, has anybody really written or talked about that? And Varoufakis has done it long before he was thrust in and thrust out. Secondly, there are two very important pieces. One is a new book by Atkinson, which you probably know, Inequality, What Can Be Done About It. He's a Brit, a well-known economist.
Ellen? Is it Richard?
I think it's Anthony.
Okay.
I'm wrong. But Atkinson, who's at LSE now, and has written very specifically about what legal changes have to occur, from the poll tax to whatever. And I'm a lawyer by training, and I believe, and I think you said you were trained in the law, or you were doing law, if I didn't misunderstand. No, okay.
Anyway, I wish.
Legal changes have to precede this business. And the second piece, which is enormously popular, is a piece by George Stiglitz, who's one of the two or three economists that have opened their mouth on these issues, and who I think, along with Jamie Galbraith, who's the son of Kenneth Galbraith, he's written something to the Roosevelt Foundation, which, as you can imagine from its name, is interested in a second New Deal. 100-page report called Rewriting the Rules. And both of these formulas, both the Atkinson, and it's not a call to arms in terms of political activism, it is a call to arms in terms of legislative and legal change. So I think these pieces really are the ammunition for you, because if you say, well, you want reform, what are we talking about? You need to know exactly what we're talking about.
Okay, thank you. I'm just gonna stop you there, because I want to make sure we have time to hear from lots of people. But thank you very much. Colleague at the back.
Just following on from that, what do you do when you've got these institutions and they're clearly set up in a way that simply doesn't allow any change? The finance minister said to Barr, you know, I think it's the title, that, you know, if you allow elections to change, obviously it will undermine the basis of the Eurozone. And that's quite a damning statement on the Eurozone. So is it possible to really, you know, which is the approach to which they took, really, which is to work within existing institutions to try to get something better, or does it require a more kind of serious rupture?
Thank you. Great question. And then colleague here
in Asia. My name is Mariana, I come from Argentina. I think that taking on the point that the first gentleman said on the need to learn from other experiences, and Latin America has a lot to offer in terms of what the neoliberal crisis might be. And I just want to mention two examples. The first one is Argentina 2001-2002. There was a huge neoliberal crisis there. The state basically collapsed. There was a lot of repression, people were killed, and basic service just was, most of them was shut down, health, electricity, whatever. So I think on the one hand, a new political party has need to expect a lot, to do a lot worse, and things can get a lot worse if there is going to be a real neoliberal crisis in Europe. And people have to start reorganizing themselves and taking charge of services, food, anything, really. But also have to start with the media, so there's no naivety there. There's going to be repression, there's going to be media confusing things. and Argentina somehow managed to pass that, but the thing is, the model that we have now is neo-structuralism again, so reindustrialization, hierarchy, political structure, etc. The other example is Brazil, 2002-2003, when Lula and the PT party came to power. And the PT party base was based on somehow same political lines as the new political parties in Europe, which was social movements, participatory politics in cities. And when they came to power, all this base was lost because they had to negotiate with existing, what become political structures. There was huge failure in some sense. So my understanding of what's happening in Latin America is we know that neoliberalism is gone and it is a failure. And we know that social movements and new kind of political organizations, self-management cooperatives, can try to rebuild some services, technologies, etc. But there is still no understanding of how the political system can move beyond that. And so that's, and there's no vision to move beyond that. So when these parties come to power, they all take their own recipes. And that's a huge problem right now.
Excellent, thank you. Could I ask for any sort of immediate responses from the panel to some of the points there? Question regarding kind of the nature of institutional change. Do you have any thoughts, Phil?
That's the key question, really. And maybe I could bring it back to transitions theory a little bit, just segue that in. Another thing is, this is a working paper with Andy Sterling on comparing qualities of democracy in relation to transitions, and this relates to the institutions question, because as an example, we were looking at nuclear power policy in the UK and Germany, and you have two completely different decisions that have been made. One, Germany is phasing out nuclear power, despite the fact that it has it's got a lot more nuclear, it's got much better industry. You know, the UK nuclear industry is an absolute disaster. It's terrible. It's extremely expensive. We're trying to build a power station that can't be built with money from the Chinese Communist Party and the French state. So it's a very strange situation. So we were looking at, can transitions explain this, the theoretical thing? Not really, no, because usually what we begin with is a focal regime configuration. We look at particular technology and its associated niches and so on. But actually, if you take that approach, then you really think that the UK would be facing a nuclear power. So then it comes to the institution. And there's something particular, if you look at every kind of measurement of democracy, the UK is way below Germany. Clearly, this doesn't relate to the international relations that Germany does with Greece and so on, but it's a consensual democracy. There's a plurality of parties. It's a non-adversarial system. It's not the Westminster model. And the problem with the UK is there is an institutional issue that we have, that change really can't happen. You know, there's one Green MP for a reason, because it's the two-party system and so on. So what can be done within that is a huge challenge. And it has to be about the kind of thing that Caroline Lucas is doing with Corbyn and so on, and with the SNP, that we can no longer rely on these institutions. It has to really be working together across, building a broad consensus, beginning from the beginning again, as Lenin said. So it's we really are at this pivotal point where the institutions have run their course, I think, and it's only through the grassroots that change can occur.
Excellent. Tina or Buckley, any thoughts? I think this is partly related. I wanted to just mention the S&P in terms of institutions. What do you do about the current institutions? You can play a part in it. It's that question of whether you want to be part of its demise or whether you want to help build something new. So you can take a role in either of those spheres. I think they're doing quite a good job by themselves, bringing about their own demise. I think people are beginning to sort of see how, especially in Greece, and as that continues, they will expose themselves even more and more so, but how undemocratic it is. And obviously we risk sounding a little bit like UKIP when we talk about sort of the Brussels bubble, but it does exist. And if not Europe, then of course Westminster is the same. And with the SNP would never have been as radical as they are if it wasn't for another project that existed at the same time as independence, which is Commonweal, which was a programme that basically engaged people in discussion around democratic participation and what they wanted to see a radical independent Scotland being. And it's interesting to note that the moment you start asking individuals about what they want to see in their political system and how they want to participate in society, we naturally tend towards something that is relatively progressive and relatively social just. We aren't actually embedded in sort of like migrant-hating, racist, sexist, sort of like, you know, welfare scrounging, insulting individuals. We like people, we like living in communities, we, you know, want to live in peace and harmony, and we want all the things that we have in the UK, such as the NHS and the education system. So the moment we can extract people from the environment we're in at the moment, which is a very neoliberal dominated system of individual freedom and free markets, and we begin getting them to think about community, we prime people in thinking about the right values. We prime them in the principles that we want to see. And that's how the SNP ended up being a lot more radical and a lot more progressive, because their policies had to fit the discussions that were happening on the ground on the grassroots mobilisation around independence. If it was, you know, another project that started talking about how to make Scotland more wealthy, and you know, then there might have been something around migration that would have pushed it more towards the right. So let's start having those kind of conversations that enable new institutions to exist, so that we can challenge the current ones, which would be Westminster. And it's to do with the integration between grassroots activism and political actors. And then on the question of political experiments, well, that's one of them. There's also a really interesting group in Denmark who engaged, well, they basically started to try developing a new political culture around the elections in March. It was a party called The Alternative, and they based their manifesto not on policies but on values. And their values were really interesting. They were like creativity, humour, empathy, desire, and something else. You know, things that we actually, you know, just bring about joy in society. And they had conversations with groups of people around what activities or what society would look like if those values were embedded within it. Granted, they didn't get very far, but in such a small country, they did manage to target quite a large number of people, and they managed to engage in that conversation, and they were known as a party to vote for. Whether they ended up being politically active or not is, you know, that's one step, and in the election for the next 5 years, they may grow. So I think the issue around political experiments is that there needs to be, you need to just try them out. They just need to be rooted in the right values, and they actually need to be, try them once, but then grow and allow them to develop and allow them to establish themselves. And I think once we stop giving up, we might actually get somewhere.
Tina? I wanted to respond to what you were saying about Argentina. I think you're right in saying that it seems like this same situation that is happening has been happening in other places before, like Argentina, Brazil, and now Greece. And it seems like at some point there is this moment of chaos and this moment of complete crisis that brings this opportunity for change, and yet straight after the same thing happens again, and we go back into the same system that we had before, even worse. I think there is a way of getting out of this vicious circle, and I think in order to get out of this vicious circle, I think we need to don't look at just one direction. You know, there is this thing that we have in politics of the savior and the hero. You know, and it's happening in Spain as well with Podemos. It's like, oh, Podemos is going to save us all from everything. And I think this is a mistake, because people invest so much emotion and so much hope in just one person. You know, in Tsipras, for instance. I mean, Tsipras was demonized, and he was a hero and a demon within hours. You had Twitter busting with messages, oh, Tsipras, oh, hero, Tsipras, traitor, you know. And I think this is an issue. And what I think this thing of like thinking globally and acting locally is something very important as well. And we see it now in the elections locally in Spain, what I was talking before about Barcelona and Madrid, that there are things that are really happening. And these things that are really happening politically and it's managing to change policies as well within these local, within those cities, it's not happening, it doesn't come from one single force. It's coming from different forces. It's not one single platform or one party that is creating these changes and is creating this mobilization. There are different parties. And there are different parties or different platforms that they are completely connected with citizenship. So there are citizen platforms. They are really connected with real problems of real people, you know, not something. And I think this is very important as well. Also, we need to understand as well, there is a real issue of political corruption as well. I mean, on a European level, on a Spanish level, most certainly, that policies are not able to pass, policies are not able to change because politicians, they have direct invested interest with corporations. And, you know, we have an ex-president, a left-wing ex-president, who is one of the chairs of the biggest energy company in Spain. I mean, and this is just one example, to say one. I mean, it's both parties that they have invested interest in this big corporation, big energy company. So this is a real issue as well. And so I don't know what can we do from any level, but until we don't manage to sort that out, this corruption issue, no change can happen either. And the activist work, what I wanted to say is that activism and the work that activists do is incredibly important. It's incredibly important for politics, and it's not one or the other. It's not either or. It's something that is extremely important to create a significant change.
All right. So comments on those observations or questions? Okay. We've got all right. So we've got let's do this side of the room and then that side of the room. So start with the colleague with the grey jumper at the back.
It was more of a new question, really. That I'm really interested in the point you made about creating solidarity between academics and activists. And so as activists, I'm really interested in what you would want from academics. And as a non-activist, how do we in academia cope with neoliberalism that's just spreading everywhere? How can we become more activist in our institutions?
Right, thank you, brilliant question. White shirt?
One thing I've noticed in some of the discussions about the various financial crises and the in various elections in different countries that have occurred since 2008 is that the right has been able to construct a very simple narrative about tightening your belt, about sort of kitchen table economics, about that is against debt, and has really, I think, it's hard to compete against with the much more complex reality of how some of these structures have actually occurred. And so to link that to transitions, I wonder, you know, we've seen at this conference this week, I think, that transitions are a really complicated thing, even for academics who spend their careers studying them. How effectively can that be brought into the media and into the voting booth of people who don't spend all their time thinking about it?
Excellent. Good question. And the gentleman in front in the grey shirt. Seat.
Sort of two strands of raising. It seems that it is sort of part and parcel of the modernity that we believe that each time is an important tipping point. You know, it relates to, right, so I have not read Mason's book, but I understand that he draws on sort of machine fragments of the marks from Complicit, and you know, there's been a long Marxist discussion about the sort of decreasing profit quota and how that inevitably, very, very soon, for 150 years or something, very, very soon, this must lead to radical change. This is inherent in the system. And yet, 150 years later, we are still saying that, well, you know, the new machines, there's something in them that must inevitably lead, you know, this is the tipping point. And also, Gopi, you were talking about, you know, what we are seeing now as sort of, if I understood you correctly, sort of temporary setbacks in a time of chaos, you call it, whereas a sort of counter-interpretation would also be that, well, you know, Europe is inherently conservative, and there's been a sort of, you know, after the Second World War, there was, you know, that was such a big crisis that thing, there was a sort of window of opportunity to do things differently, but now we're sort of getting back to business as usual, which is a very conservative and nationalist agenda. That would be the sort of counter-narrative, counter-interpretation. It's not just a new time of chaos, but actually going back to a more stable way of understanding things. And so together, is this really a tipping point? Are we, you know, can we actually say and believe in that, or do we need to sort of say it even though we don't believe in it?
I'm actually just going to come. It's probably going to.
Yeah, I think I would just
finish this side.
Sort of your last point about, I think it's, yeah, there's quite strong narratives and movements also on the more right wing, nationalist, xenophobic side, and I'm not sure whether, you know, perhaps they're sort of equally seeing perhaps a tipping point back towards something a lot more conservative, and their fear-based kind of political narratives might actually be more effective or more persuasive to, or I fear they might be more persuasive to the majority of people.
All right, I'm going to let him panel again, but don't worry, I know I need to come back and do another round. We've got ages, we've got another half hour, so plenty of time. Let's start with Guppy.
There's so many good questions.
So,
the simple answer between, I could talk for hours about solidarity between activists and academics. There's been very little movement infrastructure in the UK and internationally. In Spain, it seems to have happened without that being necessary, but we're not going to wait for a crisis here. Like, we already know that things are shit, so we're just going to like get on with it. So what NEFA tried to do, and they're working with many different partner organisations, and slowly organisations, think tanks and civil society are beginning to change in the way that they act, is to be more movement generous. And that means putting in place systems and infrastructure to allow grassroots activism to occur and to be supported, but also for our time and our energy to be put towards the relationship building side of things. So in NEFA, we work with a community of activists and a community of academics, and we're in that, we try to influence our funders to see that work is really important. And that's really important because without funding, obviously, we'll just continue doing the same kind of crap campaign we have been doing for the last 30 years. also to influence the groups that we work with in where they put their money when they get it and how they act. There's just a whole range of programs I can talk about. But if you're interested in this academic network, which is launching in Copenhagen in the beginning of September, it's the sort of starting point for asking those questions about, okay, like how do we put this work together and how do we align, and then how do we integrate our academic work into what's actually happening on the ground and vice versa. So just building those relationships a bit more. And it really is as simple as that. Like, it's not difficult, it's just that no one was really doing it and no one really trusted anyone to do it. So if you trust us, then we shall go forward with that. I just had one thing. I guess there's quite a lot of stuff around tipping points and like the extremes of like right and left that exist, and I think that is a result of this kind of crisis in democracy in Europe. Like, you're going to get people shifting from one side to the other, wanting something different, and it's that opportunity that we should
take a hold of when it comes to building something more progressive, rather than allowing people to sit in a fear-driven society, which is what is creating the kind of grassroots developments. The neoliberal narrative that I think the guy in the, yes, it was you, you know, it's had since the 1940s to become really embedded in society. So Hayek sort of, you know, he established the ideology so well and embedded it into all of our institutions, our legal institutions, our media, our finance institutions, our politics, and education. And those are the columns in which it was built. I have a lovely little diagram here, which none of you can see, but I'm going to try and show you anyway. This is a house that Hayek built. And if you can imagine, at the bottom, and if you do want to see this, we'll actually give it to you. At the bottom are the values of like freedom, individualism, and wealth. On the top of that, I suppose that's the underlay, is the principles, the way that you act. So you're wanting things like free market and choice. And then you've got the columns that they exist, the principles exist, and those are the things, like the institutions that we have, so legal institutions, education, et cetera, et cetera. And then the outcomes are things like poor distribution of power, inequality, destruction of climate. And it's obviously not what they want. What they want is wealth and growth. But that is actually the outcome of neoliberalism. So what, in terms of the narrative, one thing that we're trying to do is to start pitching more progressive voices in the media, and that's one thing. And then there's this idea of sort of pro-democracy new media that exists through technology. It doesn't feel like much now, but it will become an institution in its own right as we begin to recognise that we can't rely on the BBC anymore. We can't rely on Murdoch-driven media. People will naturally want to seek alternatives, so there needs to be energy towards creating that alternative, but also then routes to which people can read them. And I think people will, the more that we become disenfranchised by what exists at the moment, which I do believe is natural, the more we'll have a highly established alternative.
Thank you, Bethany. Dia, what do you want to go next?
Yeah, sure. So you were asking about what activists want from academics, and maybe what I'm going to say sounds a bit aggressive. I apologize in advance, but I think that there is a problem with these boxes that we have. So activists, they are in this box, and academics, they are in this other box, and I think we cannot do this any longer. We are in a situation of urgency. Maybe it doesn't feel so much in England because austerity hasn't hit as badly as in other countries, and in southern countries or in Latin America or in other places that have been suffering this for decades. But we cannot allow these differences, these boxes any longer. Academics, they need to move on. They need to leave their crystal palaces of knowledge and their computers and their talks in this really, really obscure language, and they need to go down to the ground, and they need to move. They need to join activist movements, and they need to join politics. And we are seeing that this is happening in Spain at the moment, and it's having really serious results. Podemos is being created by a group of academics from university. This is the people that are behind the idea of Podemos. It wouldn't exist without these academics actually doing that step. But those academics, they were already doing other groundwork and other activist work. I mean, they were already related with the problems that, the issues that real people are having. I mean, it's impossible for academics to understand what they needs to be done if they don't get involved with people. It's absolutely impossible. So, and yeah, and neon and things like that are really useful, of course, for creating this relation and getting people talking. But I don't think people need to talk about their experiences. They need to get into the experience. They need to experience what it is. Go to the pickets. Go to stop people getting evicted. Go to do things. I mean, experience what it is before writing about it, before theorizing. I think this is very important.
Thank you, Tim.
Yeah, I'm having a sort of life-changing experience, actually, because I'm realizing. I'm realizing that what I've been doing for the last seven, 8 years is basically been in a room reading Marx, and that's not the solution, is what I'm realizing. I've been very. Very poor, actually engaging whatsoever. I've done my bits and bobs, but what
happens?
Yeah. And I write very angry Facebook things about the Tories and that kind of thing. But because it is an emotional thing. It's the problem. It's hard work. And what happens to me and the protests I have been involved with? I was very involved at Exeter University in the setting up of the Occupy thing. But the problem was, that was all very well and good, that was exciting, but within a few hours of it being set up, you know, I was in the pub, basically, talking about Marx again. So the problem is, it's really hard work, and it takes courage, and all these kind of things, and you have to really dig in, and I realise that's not what I've been doing, because as soon as the going gets tough, it's back. To the pub with Marx and that. So I'm just grateful that I've been alerted to this, and I am extremely interested in this network that you're speaking of, and I'm definitely going to investigate that. The whole thing about what can we do as academics with the neoliberal thing that's being forced onto universities, it's the key issue. And at the moment I don't have an answer, because basically unions are being smashed to pieces by this government. But there is an issue here, I'd say, with senior academics, that because as a research fellow on the contract, there's not much you can do, because it's very easy to get in trouble and be booted out. There is a lot you can do, and you should do it, but what I'm saying is it needs solidarity, because back in Exeter, I remember when I was out on the picket and so on, there was professors all back in their office who crossed the picket line, they weren't out there and so on, and this is an issue. They need to get out there, and they need to support younger academics. And just very briefly, I know there's a lot of questions on the tipping points. I hear what you're saying, that this has been going on for a long time, and things are always in motion, of course. But there is something particular about this.
There always is.
Yeah. And that is that the OECD and so on, even the IMF, they're forecasting, this is going to be the first time that we're going to be poorer than our parents, the inequality is going to vastly increase, and if things stay the same, it's going to get very unpleasant indeed, because it's going to be austerity, and we'll see the rise of the right wing and all the rest of it that we're getting glimpses of at the moment. So I do think there's...
I know the colleague in the red shirt has been waiting for a long time. The gentleman in the brown t-shirt, and then come here, and then you guys are coming to next. Don't worry, I've seen that you're going. So, you actually need to answer the question. Sorry, I got lost in the process there. What's your question?
Thank you very much. We were talking a lot about incremental change versus disruptive change, and I take it that you are working on a disruptive, to advance in disruptive change of the institutional complex, or the regime, or the paradigm, whatever you would call that. So I really like that, to make that clear, but I will ask a rather philosophical question maybe. Is it possible to topple over this institutional complex, regime, paradigm, as long to disrupt it, as long as there is room for incremental change within the regime? I have no answer to that. I would like to discuss that with you. Because if people still see room for improvement within the regime, is it possible to topple it over?
Okay, good question.
Thank you very much. I've got a question regarding the role of cities and change. Because now we live in Europe where more than half the population is living, globally speaking, in cities. In most Western countries it's about 75%, and we're seeing a concentration of financial wealth and power in certain cities like London, obviously, and Frankfurt. But at the same time, we're seeing the rise of cities as areas of change, especially obviously in Spain. Now, obviously, the differences between countries are quite stark. In some countries, cities have entire autonomy over their budgets, whereas in the UK, the financial autonomy over the budgets is less than 10%. But I'm just wondering what kind of roles new or emerging institutions and cities will play in changing the way democracy is played out, and then also the kind of role that cities have as systems of checks and balances against each other.
Can you repeat the last sentence?
The role that cities have as systems of checks and balances against each other. So how can a city like London be balanced out over cities in the country? And at the same time, how can, for instance, in Spain, how can the cities rise up against the power of the state?
My name is Carlos Montagues, and I come from the Technical University of Madrid, so I'm Spanish. And I have to say that in my country, the Podemos is a story of success. Sorry for my voice, I've been talking too much today. And it has given hopeness to many people, and it has demonstrated the power that we have to change the things. But having said this, I'm worried about the relationship between Podemos as a niche in terms of the multi-layered perspective in a system, in a regime, it is a political party regime that we have here in Spain, and the risk of becoming a traditional political party. There are some symptoms that I think we have to take care of them. One of them is the kind of narratives we are using. A recent example is your words, Tina, about the right women. They are not women. I understand the context what you wanted to say, but this kind of narrative on the language is the kind of language that the right traditional parties or the traditional party are using in the debate in the arena. The second thing has to do with Paul Mason, mm-hmm. and others that are observing social dynamics that have a lot of potential to change the things, but when you see how these new movements deal with this kind of reality, collaborative economy, or the new emergent citizen movements that deal with environmental issues, and so on, you see that you are very shy taking these new realities as part of your program. You're not, and then it's very, very difficult, but I think that sometimes it seems that you are very reluctant to this. I am an activist and I am an academic as well, and we wonder why Podemos, for example, is so shy talking about sustainability, talking about the new spaces that are appearing in our society, also in Spain, practicing new things, behaving in different ways, and being out of the traditional mindset of what we can conceptualize from the, say, traditional political ideas, political energy.
I'm actually going to come to my two colleagues here now because I'm just concerned that we might be running long. So the gentleman in this beige shirt and then the blue shirt.
Yeah, thanks. Benjamin from Berlin. I'm aware of all these problems elections have with them, but I still would insist that democratic election is a very important, should be a very important part also of transition. And what you said about opening up platforms for civil society platforms, figuring out what people really want, that is for me a very important approach. Because still, especially coming from Germany, it's easy to say that still many people in Europe have a lot to lose when things change, or they fear they might lose a lot, because there's still so many people well off, and they have good reasons to be afraid of a crisis. And on the other hand, so many people also in this, they profit from the system, are skeptic about it. And I think this platforms you mentioned and you described, they show that the people are willing to engage in other things, and they have to know what they could opt for and what might be the alternative. And then they are more open to take a risk. And a bad example, for example, is the German unification, when the people of Eastern Germany, they fought for their independence, and then they were on the verge to find out what they really wanted to, and then they opted for the for the promising rich regime, and they were bought in, and then everything stopped. And this is really a pity, and maybe you can learn also from this bad example what you can lose when you opt for the maybe more secure and more less risky option, and what the risk in this might be.
Okay, thank you. I think it's Alex, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay. So I'd like to return to the point made by the gentleman in the grey shirt and suit. So I think it's a point that's well made. You know, this thing called capitalism, for want of a better term, has proved amazingly kind of resilient to surviving and morphing and surviving successive crises. But taking that point as accepted, if we look at what's been happening in the kind of post 2008 period, since this kind of latest phase of a perceived ongoing kind of crisis of capitalism, what I see in the civil society response, and also working as an activist myself, is that there's been this kind of rise of grassroots political movements that we've been talking about in this session so far. That's been kind of one trend. But then I kind of see another trend, which is say also is like Charles Eisenstein, for example. People that have been using this as an opportunity to increasingly generate a dialogue about an emerging interlocking complex of accelerating crises which demand a more fundamental response from us, from society, from the human race, and that what is actually being called for at this time in history is a more fundamental shift in how we live, in our values, in our way of being and relating to each other. And that also has been going on for a long time, of course, and the intellectual history of that goes back as far as you want to go, really. But my kind of, based on case study research that we've been doing in a research project, but mostly just sort of anecdotally, it seems to me that dialogue has been expanding and morphing in civil society in response to the crisis as well. And that then in turn places a challenge to this research community in the coming years to take that development in civil society discourse into account, and to have a much more radical conceptualization of just what might be changing in a transition, a much more radical conceptualization of what social and cultural things might be changing fundamentally as we go through transition processes in the coming decades.
Yeah.
So I wonder what you think of that.
We're looking at the clock. I think it might be safer to assume that we're not going to have time for another round. So has anybody who's not yet spoken want to kind of come in at this point? If there are loads of hands, I might have to be a bit brutal, but if there are one or two, I can probably... Okay, zero hands. That makes my life easier. Okay, well, we may have a little bit of time. I wanted to ask the panel to respond to those questions, but also I'm conscious that in this room we have... we don't have a huge diversity of voices, and I'm really interested to hear about how we think that the lens of kind of race and gender and social class, etc., also kind of sit on top of some of the issues that we're talking about and interact with some of those issues, because it seems to me that they're tremendously important, and that it's important that we take those into account when we're having these conversations as well. And I know that certainly, particularly the part of the donors that you're within, I think that's something that you see a great deal of day to day. So I would invite the panel to respond.
I think maybe the disruptive change point I'll pick up because I hear what you're saying, that I don't think it's an either or thing, really. You know, working in the system and then this disruptive change that comes from outside, kind of thing. In the to take it back to transitions theory, I think the whole focus on innovation and things progressing and these kind of things. The flip side to that, of course, and what I've been working on is phase out and discontinuation, these kind of things, banning things. These are the kind of things that we have to start looking at. Take fossil fuels, for example. We have to actively research how you actually dismantle dominant regimes, dominant industries, dominant political systems. And I think that's the kind of the future of the research, and that's the key challenge. So it's not that this change suddenly occurs at a tipping point. Things are bubbling, things are being worked on as we go along. So it's recognizing sort of dismantling or disrupting a system as a long kind of process that has to be worked through and has to be governed and has to be researched. So I think that's the challenge perhaps for the transitions community now, is to look towards that flip side to innovation and really research the dynamics of how you shut things down, including entire political systems. So.
Excellent. Thanks, Paul. Let's go Guppy next. I was trying to keep it vaguely consistent, but I've fallen over. I've lost it.
So toppling institutions versus continuing to work in them, if I got your question vaguely right. I think if you go back to the house idea and those columns, we don't necessarily need to topple the institution. Like, we still need media institutions. We still need legal institutions, educational institutions. It's just how we transform them. So, you change who participates in and who has power, how that power is distributed, how it's funded, and what its outputs are. And that requires people to exist in them in order to help make that transformation, but also for there to be sort of an understanding about what the new thing is that you want out of it. So I'm just trying to think of any actual institution that we do want to topple. I guess the ECB might be one of them, the European Central Bank. But for now, like, if you think about sort of the generic institutions that you want to exist, there are ways in which we can participate in them, or we can target them to enable them to transform. I'm just trying to think about the other ones. Oh yeah, someone said something about, I think it was you, who was talking about, it's interesting, but thinking about, I might go completely off piece here, but it's really useful to, when you're thinking about the kind of work you're investigating, to consider it in some sort of framework. And I think one thing that we've struggled with in our network specifically is to sort of articulate what policies or what sort of asks we are developing and why. So we did a project called the Common Agenda Project, which is ongoing, which is basically getting people to a point where they're actually thinking about, okay, if I'm asking for a new economy, like, what the hell is it? And we have a group of people who campaign and who articulate the problem, so things that we want to extract from society at the moment and we want to see the demise of. And then the sort of end point, and I think some policies that might exist are things like community energy. It just exhibits all the values and principles that we want to see, something that's, you know, community owned, it's low carbon, it's democratic, and it allows people to participate in something that is a need of theirs. And then you've got the middle part, which is the transition. So what are the policies that you need that sort of knock away the bad bits and help build the steps towards the good bit? And a lot of times we get stuck in between what's a transition policy and what's a new economy policy. And I think being able to set up a framework within intellectual thought that enables you to say, okay, like, there's this idea and it fits in this part of the pathway, will then enable activists to be able to take them on, with a bit more idea as to where it should go from there and how it should develop. I love the question about Podemos and or political parties developing but ending up becoming the same as the old system, right? Which is the question I had when I went to Spain. And I think it's it's not just political parties, it's all groups of people, it's all academics who sit in institutions that are funded by you know, money that comes from other neoliberal institutions, and how the outputs of academic institutions are sort of skewed by that. And then it's the way that civil society and NGOs are funded as well, or not just funded, but the way that they exist in society and how they are sexist and racist, and you know, middle class Oxbridge intellectuals who try to determine what the new thing is going to be. And a lot of work that we do is trying to break that down. If I could, and this is not a NEF policy, I would try to bring the demise of the NGO system, because I just don't think, as an institution, it has done what it needs to do. And as a, I don't know, can I say this? As a woman of colour, you know, facing racism and sexism in organisations that claim to be socially just and claim to fight for social justice, and I'm pretty sure if Richard was here he'd say the same thing about development institutions, we need to begin asking the question about the clear lack of diversity in our organisations and our institutions, and what that means. How on earth are we supposed to create a new economy that's supposed to work for everyone when we do not have everyone in the room? Do we need everyone in the room? Maybe not everyone, but at least some of everyone. And you know, neoliberalism and Hayek was developed by very rich thinking white men, right? And that's pretty much the way that the economy and society has been governed for all of time. So let's begin thinking about not being tokenistic about diversity. I do notice I am the only person colour on this panel, but that's okay. I think we need to really consider our own actions and the way that can help limit other people's participation in spaces that we are trying to create. And when we begin to recognise that we are not the people who should be speaking about the thing we are speaking about, and we should be developing and supporting leadership in those groups who are doing amazing work, but they're just not listened to, that we start creating the spaces that actually exhibit the values that we want in society. Anyway, that's a rant, sorry.
Not so long. Very
well spent,
right?
All right,
Tina, let's come to you, and
yeah,
then we'll wrap things up.
Yeah, of course, I'm going to speak about Podemos, trying to answer your question about Podemos' risk of becoming a very traditional party. And of course, there is that risk, of course, and that's the same question we were answering before, that risk exists. And we have seen it already within Podemos in this year and a half. The way I understand it, which doesn't mean it's the way you need to understand it, of course, but that's the way that allows me keeping working with Podemos, is that first of all, Podemos is a year and a half old, is very young, is made already mistakes that have to do with compromise. You know, you have enabled at home saying it's a electoral machine. Podemos is an electoral machine to win elections, and within this discourse they've done a lot of compromises that have to do with, you know, not talking, being shy talking about sustainability, and being shy to talk about many very things like feminism, for instance. I don't work with Podemos generally. I work in this bubble that is Podemos Feminismos that have pretty much nothing to do with Podemos. We are this fly in the back of Podemos, you know, talking and sending them tweets and saying, you cannot do this, you cannot have an all-male panel, you cannot be, you know, I mean, so within Podemos, I don't feel like I'm part of the establishment of Podemos, but I'm very critical of it. The reason why, even though all these mistakes keep happening and there is this risk of becoming a traditional party, the reason why I personally keep working on it is because I understand Podemos as a means, not as an end. And I understand that Podemos is something new that has happened, unprecedented in Europe and in Spain, that has opened up the possibility of citizenship and people, normal people, being part and taking responsibility of politics. And therefore, the democratization of politics, like for real. And I feel I want to be part of this. And I understand there's going to be mistakes, and actually those mistakes, to me, they are very welcome, because without mistakes, we don't know how to change things to make them better. So they are normal and they are welcome. And also because I understand, I mean, until a year and a half ago, I consider myself an anarcho-feminist. I mean, and look at me, I'm part of a political party now. But this is because what I have understood, what I have deeply understood, is that the only thing between the markets and the people is governments. That's the only thing that have influence, actual influence, and can actually change things. Therefore, if those governments are part, are formed by this elite of people, of male, white male, no middle class, more than middle class, well, we're going to continue to have the same type of policies. Therefore, I consider that people such as me, that they have to enter the governments. And that's why I label the risks, and I think it is important. And I think it's important, Podemos, it will be whatever we want it to be. I mean, after the first elections, internal elections, a lot of activists, they dropped off because things weren't happening exactly like they wanted, you know? It's like, it's my way or no way, so I leave Podemos. And this is a shame because all these voices, they are highly needed in order to create a real change, so...
We are just on the verge of wrapping up. Before we do, I'm going to answer two questions of... So firstly, Guppy, can you tell people who might be interested here and how they might get in touch with you to find out about the Copenhagen situation? I'll explain that about
it. Well, you can either find me on Twitter, WKB, or I'll be here. I do really need to go to the bathroom, so I'll run to the toilet and then come back immediately so you can give me your name, or I'll just leave my email on the desk here and you can just grab it, and I'll pass it on to my boss, who's the one who coordinates the intellectual side of things. If you are, like Tina said, interested in sort of expanding your remit to not just hang out with intellectuals and academics, then you can also join the New Economic Organisers Network, which is the organisers and activists group. We do have academics, pretty rad academics, in that space. Kian is one of them. you've been really quiet recently, though. So, and there are, especially if you're based in the UK, there are lots of face-to-face events people can get involved in, and also programmes that we run where we encourage academics to be involved. Don't really see the difference, because I think most of you are probably activists who just ended up in the academic sphere, right? So you're activists as well as academics. You shouldn't make a distinction. I'll leave my address here.
And Tina, I was going to say, if you want to find out more about Podemos Feminismos, should we follow you on Twitter, maybe?
I'm really not very active on Twitter, actually, because
Facebook?
It's too much. It's just too much. I feel like Twitter is about having things to say, and I feel very awkward about talking to the world like that. But you can most certainly follow Podemos Feminismos on Twitter, which I manage, happen to want to be one of the persons managing, and the page of the Facebook page. We are very active on the Facebook page, and we're doing a lot of work at hand.
Go ahead.
Actually, Podemos Feminismos, Facebook.com or something.
That's good enough. All right, I wanted to say a huge thanks to Phil and also to Kian for bringing this group together, and also to everybody who's contributed or listened or intends to go away and think about these issues as part of their work or just as part of their life. I know I found it very interesting, and I hope that colleagues here in the room have done too. And other than that, I think that's probably it. I think we should give our panellists and ourselves a round of applause.